shooters do we have? Awesome. How many Nikon shooters?
Woo!
Yeah! How many other shooters? Great. Everybody loves great prints, right?
Okay.
Would you guys like to have a great free print?
Yes.
Guess what? Canon's here with the last ever full public demonstration of their Canon trailer with some amazing printers.
Yeah.
Outside the trade show, you can walk in and get a free print made on a professional Canon inkjet printer. You guys like that?
Yeah.
After the show, though, don't leave now. Okay, Leah needs you. But after the show, you guys can leave here. That work for you?
Hoorah! Hoorah!
It will make your Nikon images look amazing. Oh, poster size, 17 by 22. Ooh, and you did say free, right?
Yes.
Do we get a free cleaning kit or a loop or anything?
The picture's enough.
All the pictures enough. All right, so let's start with a joke. What does a large pepperoni pizza... What is the difference between a large pepperoni pizza and a professional photographer?
They can
feed
a family of four.
The large pepperoni pizza can feed a family of four. So if you guys have that problem, because I think what happens is a lot of people get really hung up on, if I'm the best photographer out there, people are going to beat a path to my door to hire me for $1,000 to take a picture of their snot-nosed kid and make 15 by 25 on a Canon printer. Right? And then what happens is at the end we find out that that's not really that true. Or you wind up in one of those fallacies of life that says, God, if I could just quit my full-time job and work as a photographer full-time, I would have plenty of time to be successful. If you guys want to know what the secret to success is in business, it's not photography. It's business. And I want to introduce Leah Smithers. I have been following her. Everybody say hello to Leah. I have been following Leah for about 5 years. She is probably one of the most instrumental and inspirational local photographers that I know. She's honest, genuine, and very authentic. If she doesn't know, she'll tell you she doesn't know. She's not going to bullshit you. The information that you're going to get today in her class is absolutely amazing and breathtaking. It's not going to be about changing your photography so much as it is about changing the mindset of your life and your time. It's not how much time we have, how well we use what we have. If you guys believe in that, Leah is going to show you some things that's going to blow your mind. And it's her first time speaking.
Yeah.
So be gentle with her. All right, round of applause for Leah. Take it away.
My notebook in my bag, telling him I'll be right there.
He tells me, never mind, I'll find someone else. And he hangs up. I'm devastated. I'm near tears. I'm completely freaked out. I just ruined this moment. This isn't how I wanted to run my business. I realized at that point that something needed to change. I needed to start some sort of system. I needed to have something in place so that this could never happen again, ever. So, I didn't just wake up the next morning with a smile on my face and this genius idea of creating some workflow. And at the time, we didn't use the term workflow. I didn't even know what a workflow was. It was basically just a list. I needed to create a list of things that had to happen and had to take place every single time with every single client. So about a week later, because I needed time to mourn the loss of a client, I needed time to beat myself up. And that typically includes talking endlessly to my husband about the situation and medicating with Brahms milkshakes. When I got done with that whole process, I was then able to sit down with a clear head at my desk and start writing out a list of things that needed to happen. So today what I'm going to do is share my workflow with you and share my list of things that I do with my clients. Now, I primarily shoot weddings, so I will be talking about brides, but you can erase bride and put in your clients that you work with. So this is how we're gonna get started. So at this point, hold on. Okay, so no one ever talks about, this is me, no one ever talks about the amount of paperwork these clients generate. We all have this amazing vision in our head when we become a photographer that, you know, we're gonna be shooting in all these fancy locations and jet setting from country to country with the latest camera bag swaying from our hip, and everything's gonna be just fantastic. And, you know, you've seen those memes where this is what they think I do, and this is what I really do, and it shows a guy with a giant stack of paperwork on his desk. That's basically us. I mean, whether you're part-time or full-time, that's what we do. We spend a lot of time in front of our computers. If my computer had a set of eyes and served coffee, we'd probably be best friends. So I spend a lot of time in front of my computer. So here is the start of my list. This is my workflow. The first thing that typically happens is we receive some sort of email or phone call from a prospective client. What I like to do initially is respond as quickly as possible. And depending on what I'm doing, depends on how quickly I'm able to respond. If I'm already sitting at my computer, naturally, I'm in the position to respond typically pretty fast. If I'm standing in the store in a grocery line, it might be an hour. So how you respond, I'm asked all the time, how quickly do you respond? I respond as quickly as I can. This is the initial part of the customer service experience. This is where it all starts. If you respond quickly, all of a sudden, they're gonna look at you and go, oh, hey, she responded quickly. You don't know how many times I've heard from brides say, well, you got to me within an hour and everyone else waited until the next day, or I didn't hear from anyone until a week later. They're more likely to go with me because I responded so quickly and I paid attention to their needs. So the key is to respond as quickly as you possibly can. In this day and age, communication is key. We are in an age where people want answers now, instant gratification. They're on their cell phones. That's the way a lot of people nowadays communicate. They're sending texts, Facebook messages. You need to respond now. We all have phones. We know when emails come in. We can no longer use the excuse, well, I didn't get the message, or I wasn't in front of my computer. We know when these clients are talking to us. We know when they're getting a hold of us, and we need to respond. This also goes along the same lines as creating or having some sort of system in place. Whether you've been shooting for a month or 20 years, I do use a CRM, which is a client relationship management system. I used Obsato. There's 17 hats, there's QQ, there's a lot of other programs out there. But having this system in place where you can receive your leads and then respond quickly is also key to my workflow. So in the middle of all of this, I had set that up. So first, you receive an email and a phone call and you respond. The second thing is after you check to make sure that you are available for your client, you write the meeting down on a calendar, on 100 calendars if you need to. Make sure you write it down. That is where I messed up initially. So when I receive any sort of communication from a client, not only does it go into my CRM automatically, which syncs to my phone, I go look at my calendar on my phone, I also have two paper calendars that I write the meeting time in, so that if I'm on the go and I need to grab a calendar or take it with me or whatever, I have everything written down. The second part of this is to also confirm a few days before the meeting that we are in fact still meeting. Is this meeting taking place? You know how many times clients' plans have changed at the last minute, or hey, my kid's sick and we can't meet today. So it's always important to not only write it down, but also a day or two before just confirm with them to make sure that we're still on. Thirdly, confirm the meeting. I send out a questionnaire, and again, this is part of my personal workflow. I send out a questionnaire before we actually meet, which asks them certain questions such as, what venue are we shooting at? Are we doing a first look? Other questions like, have you picked up your dress yet? Where are you getting your dress? Just little things to know before the meeting. The more information you have about your client and the particular shoot that you're working on, the more you can start out in a position where you're diving deeper into the conversation. You're taking a closer look. It's not so general like, oh, hi, my name's Leah. So where are we shooting? You want to go in there with a certain amount of confidence in this meeting. You want to go in there already having certain key pieces of information in place. The moment I meet someone and we get past the introductions, we immediately start talking about the venue. Yes, I've shot there before. It's so exciting. I've got the perfect position for these bridal shots. I know exactly where I'm gonna hang your dress. Here's my gallery. Take a look at some past weddings that I've done. I'm already 10 steps ahead of just, you know, the initial introduction. I like to be way ahead. I wanna go into a meeting with confidence. I want these clients to know, hey, this girl has shot here 4 or 5 times. She knows what she's talking about. Let's go with her. She seems pretty confident. At least that's what I hope. That's what I hope they take away. But again, the more information you have already about your clients, the more confidence they're gonna have in you, and also the more time you're gonna save. You can spend more time talking about the deeper parts of the meeting, more specific details about their wedding day, rather than just spending so much time on general information. Fourthly, hopefully, after this successful meeting, you book them. Now, I'm gonna be totally honest. I don't book every person I meet. I might meet 5 people. I might only book one. Maybe they have found someone else that's gonna work better for them. So, you know, although I'd like to say that I'm just booking tons of people every day, that's just not a fact. Hopefully at this meeting we have, we book this one person. Also at this time, because of the way my CRM is set up in my computer, I'm able to then have my bride and groom fill out their contract online and they can sign it. Also, they can fill out any questionnaires, any additional questionnaires that I've given them, and they can sign that. They can also pay their retainer online. We are in an online age, so everything is online. It wasn't like that for me a couple of years ago. I was still mailing contracts to people. I was still waiting for the mail, the US mail to come with my check. So now we're able to get payments almost instantly. So after I book them, I send out all the paperwork, I get it back within minutes, they pay within minutes. It's actually pretty fantastic. And then, not only that, they can go back into the system and look at their balance. They can look at their invoice. They might want to add some additional services. So having some sort of online system in place that your clients can access all of that information not only makes you efficient, it lets them know what's going on, but they have more options. Along with my workflow, after I book them, I personally send out a thank you note and a welcome package. That's just the way I do things. So you can make that part of your workflow. I think showing appreciation to our clients is really important. No one writes a thank you note anymore. People send texts, but there's something about a written note that is just very special. And that's something that I incorporate into the booking process. I thank them afterwards. After they have booked, they've filled out their contract, everything's online, the CRM has their wedding date recorded or shoot date, whatever it is. I also then write down in my two separate calendars their wedding date. I don't like having all of my eggs in one basket. A CRM is nice. It's convenient. You can access it from your phone. It's great. They can look at all their information online. But think about this. What if your computer crashes? What if the CRM decides to work on their website that day and you don't have access to your client files? I don't want anyone having control of my client's information. I don't want anyone to have that kind of power over me. So, along with the CRM, after everything's recorded, I go in and I print out their contract. I print out their invoice. I print out any questionnaires that we have. Yes?
That thing sounds very cool, but what is a CRM?
A CRM is a client relationship management system.
Okay.
Yeah.
You said like 5.1
hours. Okay, yeah. And I'm going to dive into it a little bit deeper. But it's basically like there's several out there. There's ShootQ, there's 17 Hats. It's just a great way to keep track of clients and invoices and some bookkeeping and stuff like that. I love paper. I can't help it, I still love paper. But if I'm not near my computer, or say my computer's down for whatever reason, I'm still able to go into the client file and I'm able to pull all their information and still talk about their wedding day and just write notes if I have to. It's important for me to have the same information in multiple places, whether it's handwritten or in a computer. I don't want everything stuck in a computer. I still want to be able to hold a piece of paper in my hand and look at it. Okay. At this point, there's going to be a lot of correspondence back and forth after the booking process. The correspondence can go on for months, sometimes even a year before their wedding date. So we can be going back and forth, taking notes, or talking about the venue, timelines, all this stuff. At this point in time, I'm going to send out a timeline questionnaire. And this basically helps me to build their timeline. Sometimes brides will have planners, and I don't want to step on a wedding planner's toes. That's not my job. I want all of us to work together like a team. I want them to be in charge. My timeline is basically so that I can control when the photography is going to take place, when certain photos are going to take place, and the bride likes to know that as well. I don't want to show up to a wedding and then all of a sudden, well, when are we doing the first look? Well, when are we taking the sunset pictures? Well, when are we cutting the cake? Or, you know, when are we getting those pictures? I want to go in there with already a set line. This is what your day is going to look like. This is what we're doing. This is when we're taking certain photos. Again, it's not to step on the wedding planner's toes. It's more just so that I know when I'm taking certain photos. Also, the other important thing when we are doing all of this correspondence and back and forth, a lot of times, just because of the day and age that we're in, I'll have brides text me, hey, we're changing the ceremony from 6 o'clock to 5 o'clock. Okay, great. I'll respond back to her. But I always follow up those texts with an email. It is important to have a paper trail of correspondence all in one spot. So you can open up your email and say, okay, here's the trail of conversation. Also within the CRM, I'm going in there and I'm making notes and I'm changing things because the last thing I want is to be in a panic, checking my phone, wondering if she texted or Snapchatted or Instagrammed or Facebook, some sort of change to her timeline or to the shoot, whatever it is. So also it's important just to follow up with an email. The other thing too is there's a very good possibility, depending on the number of people you book, that you will have several Ashleys or several Emilys. I had 4 Ashleys last year. So every time I had an Ashley text me, I had to like make sure that my response was going to the right one. If Ashley's getting married at Red Barn on Waldo's Pond, and then I have another one getting married in Norman, I can't, you know, text specific, you know, I have to make sure who I'm writing. So then we send out the questionnaire. We send out, you know, we make sure, and I'm doing this, I'm sending out her timeline questionnaire 30 days before the date of her wedding. Depending on the bride, she may want her timeline hashed out 3 or 4 months before her wedding. It really depends. Each bride is different. But typically 30 days seems to be a good set of time. Some people might think, why 30 days? That's a whole month before her wedding. My thing is you can never plan too soon. A month is generally a good chunk of time. And the reason why is because it's not just about you and the bride. It's also about everyone else that works on a wedding day. It's about the DJ. He might have certain plans that day. He might want to play a song at a certain time. These are all things that need to be hashed out well before the wedding. The last thing we want is to try and, in a panic, work out some sort of timeline issue 2 days before she's getting married. Because she's already stressed out and we don't want to add to that. So it's important to do all of this well before. Hold on just a second. Okay, now we've hit the wedding day. The night before, part of our workflow that's not written down, but the night before, our batteries are charged, our lenses are clean, cameras are ready to go, everything's packed, everything's working. It's important that as well as taking care of our clients, we need to make sure that our equipment is taken care of. Without that equipment, we can't do our job. So all of this has to be tested well before. Recently, we were in a situation where we ran through more equipment than we would have liked. So it's important to not only have your main camera gear, make sure you have backups too. You never know what's going to happen on a wedding day. So we go through the wedding day, the equipment is packed. At the end of the wedding day, we make sure that we do a quick inventory account, make sure all of our lenses are back in the bag, make sure we have our lights. Everything is packed. The last thing I want to do is throw my camera in the car and rush to get home because it's 11 o'clock at night and we're exhausted and we can't see straight. Let's just throw it in and go home. No, we're not going to do that. It's important to pack your equipment. Now, I wasn't going to share these photos because it was a lot to deal with. October 2015, we were involved in a hit and run. No, they never found the person. Had we not packed our equipment in our cases, had we not packed everything so carefully, I don't know what would have happened. Luckily, none of our equipment was destroyed. Our bags held everything safe for us, and yes, a few weeks later, the client's photos were delivered perfectly. This just goes to show you, you never know what's gonna happen between the venue and your house. This was a mile from the venue, luckily right in front of a fire station, and the guy literally drove off. So it is important to make packing your equipment carefully after leaving the venue part of your workflow. It is crucial. Nothing ever went wrong. We had a flash that was a little wonky, but it actually still works. We don't use it, but it actually still works. So now we get to the point where we back up our images. It might be 1 o'clock in the morning, but I will pull those cameras out and I will get those cards and I will load them up on the computer and I will back everything up. And then I'm gonna back it up multiple times on different hard drives. I need to be able to see that wedding before I go to sleep. I can't sleep unless I know I've looked at it.
Where do you back up your images at?
I back them up. I have two separate hard drives that I back those up to. I'm also looking into some online cloud options. And then because the more my client base has grown, I'm going through hard drives pretty quick. So now I have one of my IT guy who's looking into a bigger backup system for me. But yeah, I mean, it's no big thing for me to go through 2 or 3 terabytes in a year. It's just incredible the amount of space. It's also important to have your hard drives in multiple locations. Luckily, I live close to my bank and they have an underground safe. So after I'm done, the next day I will take one of those hard drives and take it to their safe. The crazy thing about Oklahoma is the weather. Tornado could be happening right now, we wouldn't know. But it's important to have your client's information in a safe spot. Your house may not be safe, depending on where you live. I mean, a tornado could come, a storm could come. You could be robbed. You don't know what's gonna happen from day to day. So it is our responsibility to take care of our clients. And the other thing too is I promise that I will hold their images for a year, but it goes well beyond that. I mean, I've got 8 years worth of images. So if something ever happens with them, then I have their wedding photos.
So you said you print out all your contacts and all your
stuff. I do, yes.
Where do you keep that at?
I keep those on my desk in a simple file right there.
But then after the wedding, what do you do with it?
After the wedding, I file those. And they're in the filing cabinet. So yeah. And I haven't determined how long I'm gonna keep those either. It might be one of those things where I just sort of keep them forever. I don't know. Or maybe 7 years, like taxes. I have no idea. I'm still deciding what I'm gonna do about that. Part of my workflow is a week after the shoot or wedding, I send out another thank you note. I'm real big on thank you. I think it's gone out of style, and it's kind of a shame, but I'm real big on written thank you notes. I love getting a letter in the mail, and no one ever gets letters anymore. I love getting letters. So I think it's important to show our appreciation. These clients have spent a lot of money. They've spent a lot of time with us. We've spent 8 to 10 hours with them on their wedding day, meeting their family, maybe possibly eating, you know, in the same area as them. We've taken care of these people. We've come to really know each other. It's important to show your appreciation. A thank you never goes out of style. I don't care how cool you are, a thank you never will go out of style. You know, after they receive their images, a few weeks later, I ask for a review from the client because reviews are important. It gives a chance for future clients to see what kind of a person you are and what kind of an experience the previous client had with you. So reviews are important. I ask for a review. And then I also check with other vendors at the shoot or wedding to see if they would like to use my images for their business. Sometimes DJs like dancing shots. You know, they like a packed reception area and everyone's dancing, and they love to use those images. So it's a great way to network. You know, they have images for the work that they've done, and so I do that.
I have a question.
Yes.
Where it says ask for review, what's your medium? How does that happen?
Well, I advertise with the Knot.
Okay.
So they typically leave reviews on the Knot for me.
Okay.
Yeah. And so depending on what kind of a photographer you are, also Google is really important. So if you have a website and you're, you know, people can look you up, and then if you have a business Google page, people can leave you reviews on Google.
Okay, so it's a business process.
Yes. Yeah, and it's taken years for me to get, you know, reviews. I mean, it's not something that's gonna happen overnight. And also the other thing too, is just because a photographer or a business doesn't have any reviews, doesn't make them bad. It just means maybe they're starting out. It takes years to sort of get all of this built up.
Is that not the only place you advertise?
No.
Primarily wedding photographer?
I advertise with Wedding Wire, but we'll see how that goes. But, you know, it's give or take. I don't know. The Knot is great. I've been advertising with them for 4 years. I like them. Wedding Wire, everyone's going to have different experiences. So, yeah, just it depends. Consistency with every single client is key. You want to treat every single person exactly the same. You want to have the same steps in process, your same list. You need to make sure that every single person is treated exactly the same every single time. And having all of this written out is a great way to make sure that that happens. You want to make sure that you are running your business and that your clients are not running you. Not only that, if each client gets treated exactly the same and they typically have the same experience from you, they're gonna remember that. They're gonna remember that you took care of them. And you're gonna remind them the reason why you were hired. You're hired because you're professional. You're hired because you're gonna take care of your clients. You have a list of things that happen every single time. I am organized. This is gonna get done. And so they have that confidence in you. And that confidence does spread. So people are gonna talk about you. Hopefully not bad, but people will talk about you. I mean, bad news also travels faster than good news, unfortunately. But if you have a happy bride or a happy client, they're gonna scream that to the world. It's gonna be all over Facebook. It's gonna be on Instagram and Snapchat and everything else. So you wanna make sure that what they're saying is good. She was quick. Her correspondence was fast. She got back to me really, really quick. She took care of us. Our album was designed quickly. You want all of that. Now at this point, it's blank on purpose. I'm gonna take a couple minutes to answer any questions. We're gonna take a short like Q&A break. Does anyone here have any questions? Yes.
Do you ever visit a wedding venue in advance, particularly one that you've not been to?
If it's close by, I might.
And that's part of the problem is that some of these things are borrowed and
right.
Scheduling is difficult.
Right.
And you photograph the venue itself so that you're able to use
No. In the beginning, I did. In the beginning, when I was really kind of starting with weddings, I second shot for a number of years for another photographer. So in the beginning, I would be really scared, and I would go to venues and scope it out, and okay, where am I gonna put my lights, and this is what it looks like, and what does it look like at night? Maybe we should go again, you know, at night and see what this looks like. So yeah, I was nervous. I think everyone starts out like that, where they have no idea what this place is gonna look like. We should go take pictures. We should talk to other people who know about it. Anymore now though, not that I am overly confident, I'm still very cautious, but anymore, we generally have a set way that we set up our lighting. We have you know, it's basically the same no matter what venue. So at this point, we're pretty confident in how we're gonna handle any venue. And so again, consistency, we all of our shots, you know, even though it's a different venue, they still have the same look.
You say we, how much help do you have?
I'm sorry, how much what?
How much help do you have? You said we.
Yeah, my husband and I shoot together. He's right there. Everyone needs Shane. Yeah, my husband and I shoot together. Yeah, we're a team. So I can, it's great. I can look at him from across the room and, you you know, maybe tilt my head a certain way, and he knows exactly what I'm talking about. So if you are, you know, if you have a second shooter or something, it's important to have that kind of closeness where you can look at each other like, you know, something's happening over here, come over here, and you know, you can have some help. Any other questions? Yes?
What do you like about wedding photography? Because I've heard it is so pressure and a hard feel because of that. And I'm just curious, what is the emotional appeal to you about that?
The emotional appeal is our wedding stunk. Our wedding experience was the worst. And it really was. It was pretty bad.
So was it because of who you married?
It was our photographer.
Let me
tell you about our photographer. I still remember his name. His name was Jason. We got married on a cruise ship. Great, romantic. It was wonderful. The pictures stunk. I don't like any of them. None of them turned out well. And I think we have like 100 kilobyte JPEGs on a CD somewhere of these. We don't even have like full resolution. The whole experience was just awful. I wasn't really even into photography yet, but the more I sort of got into photography, I knew that I didn't want anyone else to have this experience. So call it greed. I want to make sure these people have a good experience, and it's my job to make sure that happens. We love weddings. We love seeing the two couples up there, and there's times where I've cried at ceremonies as I'm shooting. So it is an emotional thing. It is high pressure. It is very stressful. But depending on how you handle all of that stress, depends on the success of the wedding. So if you handle all of that stress well, and you're organized, and you're on top of things, and you have a good, strong workflow, then the wedding, from your standpoint, will be a success. Now, things are going to come up. They always come up on a wedding day. Oh, the makeup artist is going to be 45 minutes late. And we're doing the first look. It was supposed to start 15 minutes ago. So, yeah, things come up, but you gotta just keep your cool, stay organized, and just go with the punches. Yeah. Yes?
What's the name of your system that you use for your online contracts and payments, that kind of tracking service?
I use Dubsado.
How do you spell it?
Dubsado. And they have only been in business for a little over a year. They're fairly new. It's a husband and wife team. I switched to them at the beginning of this year. And I was with 17 Hats for a long time. I'm not gonna bash any company. I think each company is going to offer different things. And I found a company that offers what I need for how I shoot and how I wanna stay organized. So I switched at the beginning of this year. And it allows you to get all those client emails in one place. It allows you to send out contracts online. People can sign them. It's great. Yes?
So what do you recommend to somebody who's like fallen into wedding photography? I had actually 3 weddings recently. And of course, they're all my friends, which is fine. But I kind of now have fallen into wedding photography, and I've never considered myself a wedding photographer.
So that's your question.
I'm curious, like, what do you recommend for somebody who seems to, like, what things might
be? Oh, like the type of system
you need? I don't have flashes or any of that stuff. I have my camera, and that's kind of what I go with. Mm-hmm. And everybody's been really happy, so yay. But, like, what should I maybe look into getting equipment-wise?
Backup. You can't go to a wedding with one camera.
Oh, I have two.
Okay.
Great. You have two.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, I don't have any flashes. You recommend any of those?
It depends on what kind of photography the type of look you're going for. It depends. Now, we have multiple lights that we set up, but it's our style, and I think maybe some of the more seasoned pros in here can agree. We all have our own style, so it really depends on what style you want to offer your clients. Do you want receptions that are fully lit with all these things going off? I mean, so yeah, it's something that you're gonna have to research and really find out what kind of style am I going for? And especially when you're new, it is harder to figure out who am I. I mean, it wasn't until maybe 4 years ago I was able to answer that question for myself. It's a lot of self-discovery and learning what your style is. And what do clients see when they hire me? Why are they hiring me? You know, it's important to find those things out. And your friend is going to be able to help you with that too. Like, why did you hire me? You know, is it something about my photography that you like or whatever? That way you sort of start getting an idea of who you are and how you want to shoot and how you want to create your style. So yeah, but I would recommend if you don't have any lights, yeah, I mean, starting off with a flash or two is a good idea. Yes.
So, how many images do you typically put into a catalog you send to your clients? What's the final number, would you estimate?
It depends on the number of hours we shoot. Not all of our weddings are 8 hours. Not all of them are 10 hours and 12 hours. It depends. We average 75 images an hour. So it really depends on that. It depends on their wedding. If they have a packed reception and everyone was all hot and sweaty on the dance floor and it's gonna go until 10 o'clock at night, we're probably gonna generate more images than a wedding who had a very quiet reception with 25 people and they're eating for 3 hours out of the 4 hours that we're there. So it depends on what's going on in the wedding. That's how many.
So do you also include like your, you know, the pre-shots and, you know, things like that where you're doing like maybe engagement photos and all that stuff? I mean, would you include any of that in that?
Not in the wedding catalog, no. If we shot their engagement earlier in the year, they already have those photos. So they, you know, when I present their wedding gallery is what they're going to get. They're not going to see any other photos.
I mean, is there a size that you think is just way too much? So if you end up with you know, 1,000 images, and out of that you're going to, you actually have, you know, 600 that are actually usable and able to present. Is there a line that's like, look, they're not going to want all 600 of these or 1,000 of these or, you know?
Again, it goes back to how many hours were we there shooting that wedding. If 600 images are absolutely beautiful and they turned out, then they're going to get all 600. If I shot 1,000 and only 600 are really good, they're going to get the 600. So my clients get the very best of their book. I don't want to waste my time with a blurry image or, you know, anything other than, I try to be as perfect as possible with their images. So, yes?
How do you handle other cameras at the wedding? Is that something you deal with, like cell phones, people taking cell phone pictures?
We make sure to handle that before the wedding day. The bride is well aware that her family and Uncle Bob are gonna be standing next to us during the formals, taking pictures right alongside of us. I have no problem with that, but we've already had a conversation when she booked us about that. And our process is, we don't mind if there's other photographers standing next to us taking pictures, that's great. Grandma has her own experience of the day and she wants to get that. That is totally fine. I don't mind that at all. But when everyone's looking at grandma and they're not looking at me and I'm trying to take the picture, that's sort of when it becomes like a tug of war. So what I do is we generally like to make sure that all of the friends and family standing next to us are getting their photos before, and then we can say, okay, now it's time to look at us, and then we get our stuff out of the way. So we've already had that conversation, and then it's more comfortable for the bride to tell her friends and family, hey, look, we have photographers, just put the stuff away, rather than me telling them. I don't want to be the bad guy. I want, you know, her to already have had that conversation with them. Yes? Go ahead. Yeah?
Do you give your timeline to the other vendors?
If they ask me for it, yes, I will. And now we're working with a lot of people that we work with over and over again, like DJs. It'll be the same DJ at next week's wedding or the same, you know, wedding planner at the next wedding. So if they ask me for it, yes, I'll give it to them. If they don't ask me for it, then when we first arrive, I will share it with them and we'll just sort of go through and, you know, hash out how we're gonna handle the day. Yes. That's a whole other class. get to a point where I was comfortable with what I charge. But yeah, that literally is like, that's a whole other topic. So yeah, I'm gonna, yes, one last question.
When you send the pictures, are you just sending the files, or are you actually sending prints along with the file?
It depends on what the client has ordered. If in their collection they have prints, or they have an album, or they have a canvas, or anything like that, then yes, they get their online gallery first, and then a few weeks later, then they get everything else. So, okay, let's get back on to what we're doing here. So at this point, I'm gonna share with you five things that you can take away right now today to get this whole process started. Because the point of this, all of this, is so that you can walk away with at least one thing that is gonna, from this point on, make your business a success. So the first thing I think is really important to do is to create a workflow and write it all out on paper. When you are able to see everything written down, you see where you can change things, where you need to tweak things and make some adjustments. Without having anything written down, you don't know what needs to be changed. You don't know what needs to be tweaked. You don't know what you can give your clients. Whether you've been in business for a month or 20 years, you already have certain things that you're doing with your clients. Take those little things and build on those.
Now, is that workflow, is that a narrative script, or is it like a storyboard? Is it an outline?
I actually just wrote mine out on a piece of binder paper.
Okay, so it sounds like it is an outline.
Yeah, it's an outline, yeah. But
I don't see how you can follow the narrative script. You can get some variables to follow.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing. Each write is different. It's not a cookie cutter thing. So you take those different situations and you change it to fit that client. Basically, that workflow is the same for every single person. But if I have a bride who is maybe doing things a little differently, then I will change that to fit. So whatever kind of client you have or whatever kind of situation you're in, you need to alter, you know, change that workflow a little bit to fit that situation. The next thing I have done is I have created templates for my most commonly used emails. This is a good time saver. If you're constantly getting clients or prospective clients who are contacting you, they want to know your pricing. You have to type out the same email over and over again. It's a time saver and it keeps everything organized and moving forward. If you can already have something written out that you can just send with your pricing. Thank you so much for, you know, looking at my website. Here are my collections, blah, blah. You can send out the same email every single time. And there's been a lot of times where I've been able to stand in line at the grocery store and see that I got a lead coming in and be able to respond right from my phone just because I had all of that groundwork already laid out. There are some templates, like I love Jasmine Starr. I've followed her for years. She's a wedding photographer. But she sells templates in her client store, so you can check out her email templates. As far as contracts, it's important to have a good contract in place. Rachel Brenke, I believe right now, has a contract that you can download for free and alter it and change it to fit your business, whatever you're doing.
What was that name?
Her name is Rachel Brenke, and she's actually a lawyer photographer in Texas. Emails. When I set up my system in my computer, when I chose a CRM, it took 7 hours for me to type out all of these emails and the workflows, because in there you can have digital workflows too. It took a long time. I thought I was going to pull my hair out. So it's not a quick, easy process. You're not going to just go online and find a company and go, okay, I'm ready. You have to actually set all of this stuff up, and that does take time. So having templates where you can go in and just, you know, copy and paste, and okay, I'm gonna use this template to respond to clients who want pricing. I'm gonna use this template to respond to a client that hasn't given me the favors for her wedding album yet. And And so once you have all of that stuff in place, then it's easy to just go in there and get that email and send it out. Does anyone have any questions on that? Okay. Next step. Work on your schedule for the following week. How many of you now already know what you're doing next week? How many know what you're doing next month? Okay, good, one. A little bit management here. I like to know what I'm doing next week. I'm just that kind of person. Maybe I'm type A, I don't know. I like to know what I'm doing next week, 2 weeks from now, 3 weeks from now. If I know what I'm doing next week, then I know what my clients can expect. It builds confidence when a bride says, hey, do you know when my wedding album is going to be done? And you're able to say, yes, next Tuesday it's going to be sent to the lab. All of a sudden, you have boosted her confidence. All of a sudden, she's looking at you like, man, she knows what's going on. I'm glad I hired her. You need to lead your clients. It's important to be the leader. You don't want to control them. I'm not controlling them. I'm leading them, and there's a difference. You want to be the leader. And in being the leader and leading your clients and creating a schedule where you know what is happening next week and you know what you're going to do for them next week, you put yourself in a position where you are controlling your business. And that's the point of having a workflow. At this point, it's blank again. Got a surprise for you guys. I am going to raffle off a planner. And I believe Robert was going to help me with that. I don't know where he's at right now. Okay, he's not here, so we're just going to start without him. He's going to miss out on all the fun. Who has a July birthday? Okay, you. You raised your hand first, so we'll get the first one. Yes. There you go.
I don't want to go past that. My first birthday present.
I have another one, so we'll have another one at the end of the show. This is the same planner I use. I use a planner. I have a calendar, because I'm a freak and I love paper. I have a calendar that I use that I have open on my desk every single day that shows the month, that shows what I'm doing week to week and all that stuff. So I have like a month picture of what I'm doing. I also have a planner, like that one, where it lets me know what I'm doing day to day or next week. It's got the whole next week written out. So on a Sunday, because I'm so adventurous and spontaneous, I like to sit down with my little notebook on the sofa and maybe a movie on TV, and I like to plan out what I'm doing the following week. I like to know what's coming. It makes me feel less stressed out. When you have a plan for next week, and you're looking further than just 5 minutes from now or 10 minutes from now, you can start to plan other things. The whole point of me doing this business is for my kids. The whole point of this was so that I could chaperone the field trips, so that I could pick them up from school when they get sick. That's the whole point. I basically started doing this because, of course, I love weddings and mine stunk. But it was also so that I had the freedom to raise my kids. I wanted the freedom to create my day. And it's important, if I don't know what my day even looks like, then how am I gonna plan anything? I need to know what's happening next week. I need to know what's happening the week after. If I can design an album on Tuesday and edit on Thursday and chaperone a field trip on Friday, I won. So I like to know what's happening. Do you have a question? Okay. Well, I like to know what's happening. I had come to the realization about 2 years ago that I probably need to outsource some things I don't particularly like. It depends on the situation, depends on what I'm editing exactly, but I don't really like editing that much. It's very time consuming. The thing is, like, if you have a wedding and you've spent 8 or 9 hours shooting the wedding, and then you gotta go through 2,000 photos of the wedding. Sometimes it can be a little, you know, I mean, let's be honest, it's not all roses. So it's time consuming, it's hard. I will go through the photos and I will cull them and stuff because that is my job. But I do have someone who color corrects and just gets everything looking the same. And then I go back in and I put my creative spin on it because it is about, the client hired me for my style. So they need to see that. I want them to see that. It's important for them to get me. They hired me. They didn't hire some guy from India to edit their stuff. They hired me. So in this audience, I have Josh. Where's Josh? Right there. He is a local editor. And I want to introduce everyone to Josh. We met at a Rising Tide meeting a few months back, a month and a half ago. But he edits. So if anyone is interested in having him,
what is your last name?
Though?
I have a card.
His contact. I have his website and stuff on my last slide. So his stuff. But the whole point of this is, it's important to maybe consider outsourcing tasks you don't love. As you create your workflow, you're gonna be able to have a visual idea of what things slow you down. Sometimes things slow you down, like editing, or maybe you don't like designing albums, or you start to see your weaknesses when you're creating this list. You see your strengths, and then you see your weaknesses. So it's important, it's a time saver. When you are designing workflow, it's important to see what is working and what isn't. And if editing or designing albums is not working for you, consider outsourcing. Yes.
Do you also incorporate the cost of the outsource, and how do you do that if you're using an editor for the first time or any of that? You say, I'm going to give you 5,000 photos. Does he give you a quote and then you quote on top of that, or do you just incorporate that in the total?
I incorporate that into the total price, but when I do on occasion work with an editor, I've sent them many sample images. So I already know, you know, what they're giving back to me. I would never send 5,000 images to an editor.
Just saying.
Like, we've already established a relationship, and I already know, like, what to expect. So, but yeah, it's incorporated into the price.
Okay.
I think it's also important to maybe schedule an admin day. Take a break. Take a break from answering emails for 3 hours, or Facebook, or anything. Take a half a day or a day and work on these workflows. Create a workflow. It's important to see how your business is being run. The other part of this is if you have a partner, or a second shooter, or you have a team of people that you're leading in your business, whatever it is, it's important for them to know where you're at with your clients. If you have a process in place where you are dealing with clients in the same manner, and they're able to quickly go in and figure out, okay, she's designing an album right now, she left notes, so let's pick up and where she left off. If you have a plan in place for your clients, it's easy to see for the rest of the team where you left off. It's important. And the other thing too that we don't like to think about is, what if I die? What's gonna happen to these brides who are waiting on an album, or they're waiting, You don't wanna think about that, but you have to think about the future. Is someone gonna be able to pick up where you left off? Is your business still gonna be able to at least take care of these last remaining clients? So you have to think about the future. The last part of this, you're gonna see some funny pictures up here. These are pictures of my personal life, so just sort of go with it. But I wanted to break it up a little bit because staring at a boring camera and a notebook just, gets monotonous after a while. So this is my dog, Duchess. Just sort of break it up a little bit. You want to create, and I know there's a typo there, create a schedule that is easy to follow. We're gonna step away from the workflow for a little bit, and I'm gonna talk about your daily schedule. You want to create a schedule that is easy to follow. Start recognizing what you are doing on a day-to-day basis. Start recognizing what you're doing early in the mornings. We get into habits. I wake up in the morning, I like to have coffee, sit down at the computer, start looking at emails, respond. I've realized that I work really well early in the morning at 7 o'clock. I'm like, yes, I'm gonna edit this entire wedding in 45 seconds, you know? I mean, you've got like, you're just running, you know, in all cylinders early in the morning. That's what I've discovered for myself. You guys will all be different. Maybe you work better in the afternoon. Maybe posting and marketing on social media and stuff like that works better for you at night. Start recognizing what you're doing on a day-to-day basis so that you can plan. And this goes along with knowing what you're doing next week. Start recognizing a daily schedule. That way you can start planning weeks or a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks ahead. Do you have a question? Yeah, okay. As you're discovering your schedule, this is another thing that isn't talked about when you become a photographer, is setting boundaries. Everything is yes. I think for the first 8 years, I didn't say no once. And it burns you out after a while. You get tired. And then you start realizing how many more hours or how many more days or weeks or years can I possibly do this job? No one talks about the amount of paperwork that these clients generate and the toll it takes on your family and the hours you're going to spend staring at the face of your computer. I stare at my computer probably more than I stare at anyone in my family. I mean, honestly, let's be honest, okay? We stare at that computer a lot. And it starts to get to you. So, honestly, I'm being perfectly honest here. I didn't realize I needed to start setting boundaries until this last December. I've been shooting since 2007. This last year, 2016, and this year, I'm learning how to say no. It's not always easy. But I've realized that there are things, it's okay to say no sometimes. It's okay to not want to shoot family photographs on Christmas Eve. It may seem like a good idea in March, but come Christmas Eve, when you're in Myriad Gardens taking pictures, that's when you have to start questioning yourself. Is this something I had planned on doing? And yes, that happened. And I love my clients to death, that's why I did it. But I'm not doing that this year. In fact, I have completely marked off December. Already, I already marked it off. So I'm not doing that. I know. It's Angus's birthday today. He's one, so yes. Get a puppy. Okay. Maybe that might not work for everyone. I got Angus last May, and he has been amazing. The reason why I say get a puppy is not for you to actually run out and get a puppy. It's more to get your attention and say, find a hobby. Find something else that gives you a moment to really think about your business and think about the direction you're going. So along with setting boundaries this last year, I've also discovered balance. Balance is really important when you are first starting out or even if you've been in business for a long time. It goes along with saying yes to everything and yes, I'll be at that meeting at 5 o'clock and yes, I'll make dinner at 5:30 and yes, I'm gonna run out again and take pictures at 6. You're gonna get burned out. Find balance. I have been taking Angus for a walk. I recently started that in the last month. We never used to do that, but he's got a lot of energy. So I know that it takes me 34 minutes to walk 2.25 miles. I know this. In those 34 minutes, I have discovered what fresh air smells like. I have discovered rays of sun coming through the trees as we're walking down the street. It is 34 minutes without a phone. It's 34 minutes without email or texting or Facebook. It is 34 minutes of getting in touch with yourself and discovering how to get away from it all and just become balanced. In those 34 minutes, every single day for the last several weeks, I am more relaxed. I can come back into the office with a fresh perspective. I can come back and go, okay, I can breathe now. Let's look at this again in a new way. There are some business issues I've had where I've been trying to figure it out for so long that a walk and getting out has led me to finding the answer to some problems, just getting away from it. So along with setting boundaries, discover balance. Network. This is my daughter. She actually did this. She's having a tea party. It is important to network. When I first started out in photography, I thought I could do it all by myself. In a business that literally involves people, I thought I could do it all on my own. I didn't want help. I just wanted to come out of left field somewhere and be like the next, you know, Peter Hurley or Jasmine Starr, you know. You need people. We can't be threatened by competition or, oh, she's doing the same wedding as, you know, she's doing weddings, I can't talk to her. We need to network. Because I have an idea, if I say the same idea to 100 people, you're all gonna take something completely different away from it. And you're all gonna make it work for you. So it is important to network. Get out there, meet people. About 5 years ago, I was really sort of coming into it. I put a note out on Facebook saying, hey, does anyone want to get together and talk photography? And to this day, Eric and Tori, we still hang out. They're here supporting me today. I couldn't be more grateful. We all do separate things, but we know each other. We're friends. It is important to have friends. This is a very lonely business. It's very isolating. When you're staring at your computer for 8 hours and you have a dog and that's it, it's isolating. It's lonely. Get out, meet people. There's no, shared ideas are more innovative than solo thinking. The other important thing about networking is everyone has backups for their equipment. Do you have a backup for yourself? What if you get sick? What if you need extra help? What if a camera breaks? And oh my gosh, Robert shoots the same, you know, has the same camera as me. Oh, I'll ask him. Well, if you don't know Robert, you can't ask Robert. It is important to know people not only for, you know, gathering and you know, making friends and stuff like that, but if you're able to really connect with someone on a deeper level and they can be there for you as a backup, as a person, that is also important. And that's another good reason why you should know people.
I have a friend in West Virginia who had a heart attack and 5 different photographers jumped in and took his weddings. Tiffany Penny shot his weddings and took care of his clients.
Yeah. And that's what you want. You want your business to run like a well-oiled machine. Last year, I went and flew out to California to visit my mom for a week, and no one even knew I left because the business kept running. And that's exactly what you want. You want systems in place that are just cemented in there so well, and you know exactly what's happening. You have a schedule, you have a workflow, people know what's happening with your clients the next day, you have backups for equipment and friends and everything else. Your business is going to keep going, and that's what you want. You want systems in place for that. Have a personal project or take a break. I love taking landscape photography. Of course, I'm not as good as Eric, but I just love taking pictures of landscapes. I think they're pretty, you know, it's nice. But I'm stepping away from taking pictures of people's faces. I'm stepping away from a bride. I'm shooting a tree or a leaf or something. You have to have some sort of personal project, something outside of what you normally shoot. So whether it's the ocean or the beach or a shell or whatever, take a break. Sometimes doing nothing is everything. I mean, I can be lazy too, I'll be honest. There is nothing like getting into your sweatpants and watching Netflix, okay? Like, I love that. It's not all about photography for me. If I, on a Sunday, if I can, like, just take a break, I will take a break. Sometimes you just need to take a break and not do anything. Huh?
You want to be grounded.
Exactly.
Everything taken away.
Right. At this point, I am going to raffle off my last planner. Who has a birthday in March? Hey. Congratulations. Yeah, wow. I almost got knocked out. I might have to check your license, sir. And these are my kids. Remember, at the end of the day, why you're doing this. Have a goal. Why are we doing photography? I know why I'm doing this. I'm doing this for them. I'm doing this so that I can chaperone the trips, so that I can pick them up from school, so that we can play hooky on occasion and go to lunch, so that my daughter can be on my iPhone listening to my presentation. I'm doing this so that I can be closer to my kids. My mom was my age, and she didn't get those opportunities. It was hard for her, it was different. I knew growing up, I didn't want to be that kind of mom. I want to be very involved with my kids. So shooting weddings is great. I love it. It's fantastic. It has given me the opportunity to be the kind of mom I want to be. It gives me a chance to schedule and plan my day the way I want it. So having this career has given me a very flexible, I'm not stuck, you know, with a boss that I'm answering to from 8 to 5 every single day. I am my own boss. I am in control. But the reason why I'm doing it is because of them. Now, I have 4 kids. That's a lot. I have a full-time business, which is a lot. I'm not only dealing with the 4 kids and whatever issues they have during the day, I'm also dealing with brides. And hopefully, you're not dealing with just one client. You might be dealing with 10, 15, 20 different clients all at the same time. And you have all these balls in the air, and you've got to keep them all up in the air, and you're juggling them. And it's hard. So when people say, you have 4 kids, how do you do this? I say, I plan ahead. I'm organized. I already know what's going on. That's how I'm able to do it. And so with that, I'm going to end this presentation. Thank you so much. Don't be so serious about it. Have a good time. And if anyone has any last questions, feel free to ask. Yes?
When sending prints to, or images to a client, are you watermarking or are you
I'm not watermarking. Not the final gallery, the wedding gallery that they get. That's all fully edited and watermarked.
Hey, thank you guys. Big round of applause for Leo.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we have food trucks outside. The cannon printers are outside. At 1:30, we're going to give away some prizes inside the trade show. 1:30, be inside.